Hello everyone, this is Marcy and we are going to be working today on the table cover or coasters. The table cover comes with a piece of paper and it will felt into approximately 15 inches by 15 inches. We have a base color. Basically that's the color that's going to be put down all across the bottom, and then we have pastel colors to go on top. What we do is we start out with the roving. This is called standard roving, which means it is combed the same direction, so all the fibers are laying the same direction. And as we lay this down, we're going to be cross-hatching, and I'll show you that in a minute. Your kit comes with two barbed needles, and they look like this when they come in. They are barbed from about here down, so it's hard to see, but it's about this much of barbs. They all go in one direction, which is pointing down, and the purpose of these needles is to simply force the fiber through the paper and have it stay in place. And I will show you that as we go on. So we start with the standard roving, and I like to start with an edge that I have already pulled apart. Now, because this is really high quality roving, holding it together like this, you're going to have a hard time pulling it apart because the staple or the length of the fiber is very, very long. So you want to hold it further apart and pull gently, and it will do this. This actually allows you to then draft, and I will show you what drafting is. Drafting is where you are pulling out very, very nice tufts at the end of that. And we're going to start at the top and work forward, or work down rather. So when you're drafting, you simply pull out chunks of roving and you lay them down. And the cross hatching comes when you lay the fibers across each other. What happens is, as these fibers felt together, those interwoven fibers are going to get much stronger this way than they would be if they were all facing the same direction, because the fibers will shrink in the direction that they're laying. And if they're all going in one direction, they'll be very strong this way, but they won't be very strong this way, and you would be able to pull it apart. We don't want that, so we're going to cross hatch as we lay down these fibers. And we're going to do several layers because we want to cover the entire area, and we want to make it, you know, nice and thick and a good base for the design that we're going to make on the top. So the way I tend to work, I lay down a lot of fiber and then I tack the fiber down. If you're just starting this, you might find it more successful if you tack as you go. So you would take your needle, you can either use one or more than one at a time, but you would start tacking it down just enough to hold this in place. So every inch and a half or inch or, you know, whatever's necessary. You can see how I'm doing this. There are a couple of things that happen when you do this, which I will show you when I'm done with this section. Okay, that's enough to give you an idea. It's not covered as much as I want it to be, but I just want to show you what happens on the back. There are very light sections of roving that have come through. Here we go. Maybe you can see that. The roving gets pulled through by that needle and left behind, and it allows you to attach it to the paper so that it doesn't come off. And that's the purpose, or one of the very important purposes of the paper. The paper will allow you to hold everything in place and to get it wet without it falling apart when you do get it wet, because you're going to need to get this piece wet and agitate it in order for it to felt. So I'm going to go back and cover a few holes. Oh, the other thing I was going to show you was, see the shadow of my finger? The light is shining through. You can see that this is a very fine layer. So as you're working, if you hold this up to a light or to a window, you can see areas where you need to continue to add fiber to make it more uniformly covered. So just keep laying down the fiber, cross-hatching as you go. And I did not start off with a very good coverage at the edge. And I do like to use all the paper that I've got. Once the paper is dissolved, it's no longer there. You're not going to get it back again. So you might as well use everything. You can always cut this, which is kind of a sacrilege. But you can cut your felt on the edges if you don't want it to be as big or as long. I'm going to start by taking little slivers or sideways hanks of this. I'm turning standard roving into what we call pencil roving, which is a smaller piece of roving, and it allows you to kind of draw pictures and such with it, or use it as lines rather than basically what I'm doing is just laying down a trail of this roving, kind of twisting it in a way as I go. Not really sure what's going to happen with this, but we'll start and see where we go. That one came off so easily, I just decided to keep doing it. This particular one, I'm just going to finish off the corner there, like this. This isn't really suggesting any particular item to me, so I'll just keep doing this until I get inspired. If I don't like something like this, say I get this down partway and I say, ooh, don't like that at all, I'm just going to rip it up. I can start again. So if I didn't like that, which I kind of didn't, I'm going to start with something else and see how that looks. And just so that I can get all the different colors down on the base to see how they look, I'm going to go ahead and finish with the yellow. This kit actually comes with one color of solid standard roving for the base and another color for, five different solid colors for embellishing or designing. So getting a little more difficult because I'm having to lean so far, but I don't really want to lift this up. So let me twist this. Okay, this is looking kind of fun. I'm just gonna keep playing with these lines and see where they take me.
Thank you.
Okay, I think I'm going to call this done. Okay, we want to pull this off of the board again because it's all tacked down now. So we pull it off. I am going to put this on top of a piece of plastic. And the plastic needs to be bigger than the piece that you are wetting or wetting down. If I were doing this at home, I would put this on my deck at home and I would just spray it there. I'm using a pump sprayer that you can get at the hardware store. It's usually used for pesticides or something like that. You do not want to use one that has ever been used for pesticides, so buy a brand new one for this process. And it's basically a sprayer that will, you can pump full of air, and then that will get the water to spray out onto your piece. So once you've got it pumped up, you basically just spray and totally saturate your piece of Artfelt. And it takes a lot of water, so I might have to do this a few times. It's not as easy to see on the pastel colors how it changes, but the water will first bead up on the wool and then it will start to sink in and get totally wet. We're going to be pressing down and making sure that it's completely saturated. You see over in this area where the water has actually gotten the paper underneath wet, that is what we want. We want to saturate the paper. It's going to turn translucent and basically disappear, or look like it's disappearing, when it's wet. Okay. Ideally, the piece of plastic that you have is long enough so that you have enough to fold over on the top and start rolling it. This one really, well, I could try it. I was going to say it's not really long enough, but I think I will try it just to see. We want to start at the beginning with a piece of either bubble wrap or a dish towel or something that is long enough to allow you to roll it around, allow you to roll your Artfelt piece around it so that it doesn't kink. This is not yet wet enough. It's getting there, but not yet. This is a fairly small sprayer. There are others that you can get that are bigger and will hold the compressed air longer. Okay, that's better. See how it changes and becomes darker? And as we roll this up, we're going to be able to see, or not see rather, the back, the paper. The paper is there, but because it's completely soaked and saturated, it's kind of disappeared. And you just want to roll up, keep getting the piece wet, and roll it up completely. Some of the places where the wool is very thick, or where I put it down in rather large chunks, I want to really saturate them. Make sure the water is completely through that, because the wool has to be completely wet in order to felt. If I were to throw this into the dryer like this, it might felt a bit because of the heat or because of the agitation, but it wouldn't be the same. It wouldn't be as much. I've actually had wool that I had left in the back of my car, in the trunk, when it was very hot outside, I've had that felt. Not so that I couldn't get it apart, but just kind of the yarn would stick to itself. I'm using another piece of plastic just to get this totally pressed down, but I'm not going to use this piece of plastic to roll it up. I will continue to roll with this one. And now, because plastic is touching wool, I don't have to worry about it sticking to itself. This has taken, when I went away, I filled this up completely, and it's taken almost the whole thing. I just want to make sure that this is totally, totally soaked. Putting down my plastic again, just so that I can press down. If I were to do with this with my bare hands, the roving would come up off of the paper, because my wet hands would be touching that, and it would just pull it right off, and I don't want to do that. So here we go. We're going to finish rolling it up. Oh, and see all that water come into the nice and soaking wet. In fact, probably too much, but we're going to keep rolling. Put down a piece of paper towel to catch some of that. As, though I do want it wet, I don't really want dripping standing water in my workspace. So there we go. And you just make sure that you roll it completely so that there's plastic all the way around it. And then we're going to put it into a stocking. If you take a knee-high nylon stocking and put your hand into it, grab the end of your roll, just pull it straight over. Believe it or not, it's stretchy enough that it will go all the way to the end. And as you can see, the standing water here, this is really, really wet, and that's the way we want it. I'm going to go throw this in the dryer for 15 minutes to start. I'll be right back. I hate to say it, but this ended up being in much longer than it should have been because I got distracted and did something else. So our 15 minutes became, I don't even know what it became. And our first time in the dryer looks like this. This would be what I would expect after at least two times in the dryer. And even though it didn't stick to itself, it felted very, very, very much. So, to be quite honest, because it's still wet and I can stretch it out like this, I might be able to save it and have it be what I want it to be originally. So, in some ways I got lucky in that it went very far in the felting process. This is felted probably as much as I'd want it to be, but I would have done it in two or three goes as opposed to one long time in the dryer. What happened was this was not rolled very tightly. It kind of unrolled from its plastic and did its own thing in the dryer. You can tell, well maybe you can't, but I can tell by pulling on it that the edges where I had these stripes were very firm, and the middle where I didn't have so much, when I pull it, you can see it pulls quite easily. So this was fairly thin compared to what's going on around the edges. It's also a bit wider here than it is here. I might be able to fix that by stretching. The thing of it is, once you get to a certain point in felting, It's better to check often because you can't really go back. I can stretch this and basically block it to be a size that I want. This is not a complete disaster in that I like what I've got. It's not at all what I expected, which is typical of my working with Artfelt. What I have in my head when I'm working very often is not what it ends up being, but that doesn't mean I don't like the end product. The end product is usually really fun. I don't know if you can see my original whale. I can still see him. I definitely lost the flower shape that I thought I was going to get. It's very hinted there and here, but it's not nearly as strong as it was before it was felted. This edging, I have a little bit of a wispy there, which I'll probably cut off. This uneven bit here has to do with how much roving was on the end and on the edge, and how it felted. But it is not the way we should have done it. Basically what should have happened was I put this in for 15 minutes, got back to it within 15 minutes, unrolled it, looked at it, rolled it back up the other direction, put it in for another 15 minutes. It probably would have gotten to a similar felting state, but it would have happened in two goes of 15 minutes rather than one of 30 or whatever it was in there for. So this is a very wet piece right now. Okay, one of the other options for boiling the water is to actually boil it in a kettle. In this case, we have a roasting pan full of water, and it works pretty well. It's especially good for large pieces. So we have our table topper, and the paper is still on. We're going to just put that in there, get it completely saturated. And you notice the water was boiling when I put it in there. We're going to swirl that around, make sure it's completely saturated. And then I'm going to take it out of the water and put it into the sink.
There we go.
Okay. And if you have a sprayer, all the better. You want to make sure that you have no sticky, gummy residue left. And this feels really good, so I'm sure we got rid of all the starch in that go. When you're done, you want to roll this up in a towel to get out the most water you can, and then let that air dry. I'm going to roll this up in a couple of towels just to get rid of as much moisture as I can, and then I will let it air dry. I do tend to like to iron my pieces because I like the finish that the iron gives, but you don't have to do that. And my towels are a bit stained from other projects, not roving, so ignore that. I'm just using this for drying. And there you have it.
Okay, now that we've finished our piece, and this happens to be a 21 by 21 inch square, I'm going to show you one method of wetting down a piece this size and getting it ready to felt in the dryer. Since there's no plastic provided with your kits, you need to have a piece of plastic. Now this here happens to be a clear garbage can liner. Alrighty, I'm going to take one and set it aside. And here you can see how big my plastic is. It overhangs all sides. And it's got some extra space on one end so that I can actually roll the entire piece and cover all the paper when it's rolled. And you'll see what I mean in a minute. So the method I'm going to use is by just using a spray bottle to get my piece wet. Can also take my plastic and I can look on the bottom and I can see on the bottom side that it's pretty well saturated. I can see the paper has become transparent, so the paper has gotten nice and wet. So it looks like I've done a pretty good job on getting my piece nice and wet. So what I want to do now is I like to actually roll my piece with a towel or something in the middle. And I've got this little pink towel here. And it's already wet. Your pink towel does not, or whatever towel you're using, does not need to be wet. But I'm going to overlap this here. And then I'm going to put my pink over here. And I'm actually going to come from the side here. And I'm going to start rolling. Now I don't want my towel to actually touch this part. So what I'm going to do is, got my piece a little too small to avoid that. So I'm actually going to get myself another little piece of plastic. And if you run into this problem, you're going to be glad that you did this if you do it. What will happen is if you are actually working on your piece, this is not big enough. If you're actually working on your piece and anything touches, you know what we'll do is we'll just do, If anything touches the felted part, it will stick to it, which means that if I were to roll it, let me show you, with this like this, okay, and I started rolling like this, all of this would felt to this, and we don't want that to happen. So that's why I've cut myself another little extra length here, and I'm going to put it down here, I'm going to put that there, and now I'm going to roll it. There we go. And I know the piece is nice and wet because I can see in here how wet it is. And I'm just sort of squeezing it a little. I can feel the water gushing, so I know it is wet. And I'm just gonna roll this nice and tight. And see right here, you can see how the water just sort of puddles up. So there you know, it is nice and soaked. And when I come to the end, see there's some water running out there? That means it's nice and soaked. In order to make the coasters, you're going to want to put a grid line on your paper. What I have done is I have actually divvied up the 21 by 21 into 9 7-inch squares. So easy enough, measure 7, 7, 7, and 7 and draw your lines. I highly recommend that you either use a Sharpie marker or you use a pencil when doing this. If you use a ballpoint pen or something, when you dissolve the paper later on, sometimes those pens, actually the color dissolves in the water as well and it will bleed onto certain colors such as a white, and you don't want that, whereas Sharpie for some reason never bleeds. So if you use a Sharpie marker or a pencil to divvy up your paper, that would be great. You can do it on either side of the paper. The paper actually, both sides are identical, so it doesn't matter which side you write on and which side you lay down on. Now I have my additional colors here, and this is for my coasters. Now, there are several different ways to do the coasters. You could also just cover up your whole piece and then cut out little pieces at the end, but I'm actually going to show you how to build yourself your 9 coasters on here, and then when your paper dissolves, then it will fall apart and you'll have 9 individual coasters. So first thing we want to do is we want to lay our background material. And our background material is actually going to hold our whole piece in shape. So our coasters are going to have a brown base, and then they're going to have design work on top of them. So once more, I'm going to do a drafting motion. And because we're going to try to stay within these squares, going to be a little more time consuming. There we go. But I think what we're going to do, there we go, is just lay these out, and then I'm going to go ahead and tack it in. Notice I put down two layers, one in each direction. And then if I want to have my edges a little smoother, I'm going to want to pop them over, which I can do like this. And I'm not going to worry about getting these in a perfect square for several reasons. Number one, if I wanted them in a perfect square, I would probably use the other method, which is where I actually cover the whole paper and then cut out the squares individually once it's a little bit felted. But on this one, I'm just going to keep it easy and go like that. Okay, so now I have actually made all my squares. So these are all the base for all my different coasters. And now what I'm going to do is put designs on them. So for one of our table runners, we actually put lots of different polka dots and so on. And in this case, I think we're going to do something similar, or maybe we'll do them all differently. I think we'll just have some fun. You may notice that none of these squares are absolutely perfect, and that's actually okay, at least for me. If you happen to be one of those people who is very particular about having everything exact and so on, then you may want to actually draw a square inside of the squares and then line up, you know, your fibers exactly on the lines. For me, it's not necessary. I know that when they shrink, they're not going to, or when they felt, you know, they're not going to shrink exactly evenly anyways. This one's going to be a little bit, you know, smaller than the others, a tad bit, and that's okay. They're handmade. That's life. That's good. So we've got these different colors here, and I think this time I'm going to start in the middle, because this way my hands won't be touching this corner or this piece when I'm working on it later. I'll work on the middle piece, and then I'll work on the outer pieces in a circle. I'm not quite sure if I'll divvy up the colors exactly. I sort of like to do things as I go along, and we'll just see where it takes us. Thank you. Okay, so now I have completed all my different coasters. You can see on the back, I've tacked it in pretty thoroughly with the different designs. You can see all the different tack marks. And so now what I'm going to do is I'm going to do the wetting process. Okay, so now we'd like to get this ready to actually felt, which means we need to get it wet. And there's many different ways to get your projects wet. The way we're going to wet this one today is simply I'm just going to do it on my mat here. I'm going to place myself down a piece of plastic. In this case, I'm using a garbage bag. This is a 33-gallon clear garbage bag, and it happens to be just the right size for me to be doing my coasters. And if I put my coasters right down on top of it, and then I roll it up, if I start here, because you need to roll it with plastic, if I put the plastic down first and I just roll it like this, you'll notice at the end I have enough room to have the whole thing rolled up in a nice tidy little way. So this bag is what I'm going to use today. I've got myself a sprayer. This is actually made by Ace. It's a pump sprayer. Works really well. I highly recommend getting one of these if you're going to be doing a lot of artfelt. You just pump it and you can spray. Now please do not go in your garage and take one that someone's been using, you know, with pesticides or something like that. You want to use a sprayer that's just used for artfelt. You don't want it to have anything else in it. Not good for you, not good for your felt. Heaven knows what it would do to the color. So I would highly recommend, you know, just buying one. I think an investment of $10, if you're going to be doing a lot of this, is really worth it. You could also be doing this in the bathtub with a handheld sprayer. You can do the lasagna pan method, which we show with a lot of our shawls and scarves. There are so many different ways to get your piece wet, but I have to say this is probably one of my favorites because I have the most control with this. The only time I really never use this method is with my scarves, and usually with scarves, because they're so long, I use the lasagna pan method. It works better. So these are pretty thick, so I'm really want to make sure I get these nice and wet. Okay, everything's looking pretty saturated. Notice how the paper becomes translucent once I actually get it wet. So if I lift the paper slightly, I don't want to lift it too much, but I can see that it's translucent on the bottom, so the water's gotten to the bottom. So as far as I'm concerned, I'm thinking it's pretty well soaked, and when I press down here, the water is actually squirting out, so I should be pretty good. Now I am just going to roll this like this, and it is looking like it's pretty well soaked, which is great. Notice there's some water popping up here, so this is going to make a little mess on my board, and that's okay. I can wipe it up in a minute. I'm going to roll this out like this. I usually get these when they're on sale. You can use old ones that you have, an old pantyhose too. That's a good recycling way to do it. I do so much of this, unfortunately. I don't wear enough pantyhose, so. And then you can tie a knot in it, which is what I'm going to do, like this. I don't want it to fall apart, though, so pull it really tight there on the end. And now my log is really, it's quite heavy, which means it's full of water. You can probably squeeze it and have water come out the bottom, which is actually good, and this way it's going to go in the dryer. And I'm going to put it in for 10 minutes to start, and then we're going to take it out and check it. Okay, most challenging part accomplished. And we're going to slip this out of here and see where we are. I'm going to unroll it. There we go. And right off the bat, I can tell already that it's felted somewhat. I haven't even unrolled it, but you can see here on the back of the piece how the paper has already crinkled, which means that it's already starting to felt nicely. So if I unroll it, I should be able to see how well it's felted. And I'm gonna stretch it out a little bit. And there I can see my different coasters. It has felted quite a bit, but it's not enough. I would like to see it felt a little bit more. When I use my finger, I can still pull some of the roving off. So what I'm going to do this time is I'm going to roll it the other way around. So I'm gonna move that a little bit more down there. I'm gonna turn this whole piece around. And the reason I'm going to do that is because it does felt a little unevenly. Some sides will felt more than others. The ones on the outside usually felt a little more, and you can see here that these have already gotten a little smaller than those. So that is something that I sort of want to avoid. So I'm just gonna put this over this. And start rolling it. And it's still plenty wet. That's the one thing that you always want to make sure is that it's nice and wet. Because the last thing you want are dry pieces to go in there. You want it to go in there wet. And I'm gonna actually pop a couple holes in there. Because remember, we have a double bag, and that's why it's doing this. Oh, that's not gonna work. Yep, I have a double plastic sheet. So if I go like that, though, it'll work. There we go. And once more, I'm gonna take the same stocking. I'm gonna grab the end, pull it up, and tie a knot again. And back to the dryer. Okay, so now we've taken it out of the dryer for the second time. It went in for another 10 minutes. And this time I can get the knot open a little bit easier. And let's get it removed and let's see where we stand. Aha! So, this time, if you look once more, it's even more wrinkled on the back. You can, it's a rather dark color, but you can see how the paper here is actually wrinkled and that comes because the paper does not shrink and the roving does. So it looks to me like we are probably done. There's a little bit in here that concerns me a tad bit, but not much. It's only because it's a little more dimensional. I think in general, we are good to go and we can actually dissolve our paper. Okay, so we have taken out our coasters from the dryer and we still have them all in one piece. And now what we're going to do is magic. I'm gonna turn it upside down like this. And just sort of stick it in my sink like this. I'm gonna get my pot of boiling water. And trust me, it's boiling. It just finished boiling, it's a kettle. And I'm gonna pour it over. All my pieces. Now, this may not have removed all the paper from it, but
Ooh, ooh. Oh, I'm sorry. I just got the cameraman all wet. Sorry. Now if I rinse it a little bit. You didn't need to be dry, did you? I have all individual, well, they're slightly detached. I guess I got a, some of them got, let's clear them up a little bit here. I still feel a little starch in here, so I'm going to want to go over it one more time. But I should have 9 distinct coasters in here. I might not have to rinse it again. I'm getting all that gooey stuff out. There we go. It's sort of like pull apart pieces. There we go. So coaster number 1. And coaster number 2. And coaster number 3. And coaster number 4. Oops. So I might want to clean up my edges a little bit on this, or if you like them that way, you can keep them that way. Here's coaster number, I think we're on 5. That would have been 6, because this is 7, 8. Oh, this is 7. Okay. The wet man's dying. There's 8. 9 very distinct coasters. There we go. So you can see here, I got a little bit of goobers of paper still. So I'm actually going to go over these one more time with some boiling water. Just because there are little bits here and there. And then if you don't like the edges, some of these sort of transferred to one another, you can actually put it back in the dryer, and these edges will probably felt right in if you did it for just a few minutes in a bag. Or you can just leave them, or you can cut them. There's lots of different ways to do it. So, but there you have your distinct coasters all done on one piece of paper.